Hello, everybody. It's Mike, and I'm going to talk about a big movie. And the movie that I'm going to talk about was the final film in my trilogy of cinema hopping yesterday. I started the day off with the 3D animated CGI kids film Ron's Gone Wrong, went over to another theater and saw the indie drama Mass. Good movie. Check it out. And then finally, in the late evening, I drove all the way to Universal Studios Hollywood to go see the movie Dune, the 2021 remake directed by Denis Villeneuve. And I have to tell you guys right now, this is incredible filmmaking. This movie has such a stacked cast, and I have a feeling that most everybody that was in this movie has either been in or involved with a Marvel or a DC film or some kind of fantasy film and the like or something like that, because this is an epic movie. And it was one of those films that was held over from the pandemic. It was supposed to have come out last year. I am so grateful that this is a film that's not strictly relegated to streaming like it could have been. I'm glad that it was held over for IMAX, because the cinematography in particular from Craig Frazier, it is nothing short of breathtaking. The aspect ratio opens up to a 1:4:3, and it takes up that whole IMAX screen. The IMAX cinema that they have at Universal Studios AMC is one of the very few true IMAX theaters. I believe the screen is almost 55 feet wide, but it is 79.5 feet tall. And those of you who have been looking at my Instagram posts and my Facebook posts that I posted earlier today, you can see the difference. That one picture with Timothy Chalamet with a tear in his eye, that looks like a rectangle because the black bars are there, because those are the anamorphic shots. But those IMAX shots, you can even see the ceiling tiles. It's taking up from the ceiling to the floor to the corners of the wall. I had to include those photos just to show you an example of why you should see this in IMAX. I know the film has been out for 4 days now as of this recording, but I know you can also watch it on HBO, but please, I implore you, even if you can't find a genuine IMAX theater or you have what's called a LIMAX theater, still go see it. Because even a LIMAX theater, as they call it, even that has at least the good audio and you get some bit of good resolution, because oh my God. I mean, this is definitely a film that's certain to be nominated for its visual effects and production design. I mean, I thought that the photography that Freddie Francis did back in '84 for the David Lynch film was good enough. That was shot in Todd AO 35 anamorphic, and that looks spectacular enough. But again, this film has a more monochromatic feel to it. It's a lot darker. The colors are a bit more stale, but it's still very vivid, and it's also very bright. And the music score in this film is done by Hans Zimmer, and it still kind of has elements of like his Dark Knight score. Not like that really detracts. That's fine. It's a very Arabic sounding score, and it's very percussive. It's very rapid here and there, but I'm not going to lie, I still do prefer the score from the group, the band Toto, as well as Brian Eno with his Prophecy theme. I will tell you that much. You know, there's two things in this film that I think the '84 movie had from David Lynch is better. And like I said, one of them is the score. While I do love Hans Zimmer, I do enjoy the score a whole lot more in the Lynch film from 1984, particularly the scene where Paul in that film, he finally learns how to ride Shai Hulud, the big, you know, worm. And I swear, that score is so percussive. It is so jazzed up. It's got the orchestra. It's got the rock sound to it. Every time I watch that 1984 film, the moment Stilgar climbs up that worm and he joins Paul and he ties the ropes together, that electric guitar kicks in and the choir hits. I mean, even now, I mean, I get goosebumps every single time. That score, again, is top tier. And the other thing that the 1984 film does better is the casting of the Baron Harkonnen. I mean, listen, I'm a feisty gay guy, so I already live for an over-the-top performance. So even though Stellan Skarsgård gives a more grounded and a more appropriate performance in this 2021 film, complete with a huge bald head and droopy, you know, chin and titties and everything else, I got to give it to Kenneth McMillan from the 84 film, because he was so disgusting, he was so vile, he was so over the top, he was maniacal, he was even funny. I just got to give it to him. I'm sorry. Again, Stellan did a good job, but Kenneth McMillan, I'll take that over the top performance any day of the week. But other than that, everybody does a great job. I really liked Timothy Chalamet as Paul Atreides. He was good. I would say he is an equal to Kyle MacLachlan from the original. They're both good, but I can't say one's better than the other. They're equal. Everybody else, great job. I could definitely see some similarities between the two films. It definitely drags its feet sometimes. I am not going to deny that. There are moments where I felt like, okay, this movie is really long. I mean, lately, a lot of these big epic IMAX style films are so damn long. I mean, a couple weeks ago when I saw No Time to Die, that was 2 hours and 46 minutes. This one is 2 hours and 35 minutes. And next week when I go see Eternals in IMAX, that one's 2 hours and 33 minutes. You see, Warner Brothers is talking about maybe not doing a sequel because of the box office, not failure, but lukewarm, you know, receipts or whatever with how much it's making. And here's the thing, when you have such a bloated runtime, that damages the movie for a few reasons. One of the reasons is because people, they don't want to sit through something that long. You got to use the bathroom. And another key thing is when you have such a strong and long runtime, it limits your capacity on showtimes. I mean, currently there's only 2 showtimes in IMAX. There's a 6 p.m. and a 9:45 as of this recording at the IMAX at Universal. So that's another problem. You're going to limit your show times if you make something more than 2 hours and 15 or 2 hours and 20 minutes. So never hurts to cut back just a little bit because it's hard to squeeze all that in there. But other than that, this was definitely worth the wait. I'm glad that I got to go see it. I'm hoping that they do make this planned trilogy, because this movie definitely was a setup, but yet it still stands on its own. I don't think this should be a movie that's just a one-off, because it really wouldn't make sense in the grand scheme of things. It definitely needs to continue from here, because so far what's been done has definitely caught my attention and I want to see more. I know a lot of people have been saying that Frank Herbert's Dune is unfilmable. I watched the documentary of Alejandro Jodorowsky's Dune, which was supposed to be made in the 70s. That's a good one. You should definitely check that one out. It's a shame that never got made. But even the David Lynch film, I mean, he had never read the novel and he still made this. This was his first and I believe only big studio film. And I think he did good enough. I'm glad that it has a cult following and it's still appreciated. And this film, they finally got it right. Third time was the charm, and I hope we can proceed from here, especially with the stellar cast that we have, and especially with the aesthetic that Denis Villeneuve has given us. So this is a great movie. Definitely recommend you see it on the biggest screen possible. I am easily going to give Dune 2021 an A+. Like I said, great movie. Remember, it's only part one. This is not the end. As the character Chani says by Zendaya, this is only the beginning. Anyway, thank you guys so much for watching my review of Dune. Check it out. It's in theaters right now. See you later.